And to the analysis of Shields and Brooks, indicated columnist Mark Shields, New York Times columnist David Brooks. First, Mark, what is there to say about Newt Gingrich after this week?
Well, Jim, if you're a Republican interested in electing other Republicans to office, the downside of a Newt Gingrich national campaign has always been greater than the upside of one because of Newt's proclivity, his habit, his inclination, his irresistible tendency to always speak in sort of bombastic, superlative, exaggerated words that, and exclamation points. And that's it. I mean, he wants to draw the starkest extremes he can between his position and those on the other side. And that's what he did. He went onto a show, Meet the Press. This wasn't an on-the-run 250-watt interview radio station from Fargo, you know, just getting you between planes. You go on Meet the Press, you sit down beforehand, you go rehearse your answers, you anticipate what they're going to ask, you know what they've done. And he went on there and basically just savaged what every Republican in the House had voted for except four. The Paul Ryan plan. Ryan, yeah. And then he was classic Newt. He said, any ad quoting what I said in the Meet the Press is a falsehood. Now, I mean, this is a YouTube world. I mean, it's there for everybody to see, and it's going to come back next year, whoever the nominee is. So, and it probably almost certainly won't be Newt Gingrich.
Do you agree? I mean, is he damaged beyond repair?
I've always thought he was damaged. I think I mentioned that
I
wouldn't trust him to run the 7-Eleven. And this is sort of the reason. Somebody made the point, you always have to use the Newt Gingrich translator for everything he says. So when he says something is world historical, that means it's sort of moderately important. When he says it's fundamental, that means it's tangential. So you got to, the bombast meter always has to be ratcheted down six levels. And this was just bombastic out of control. But there was a serious element. He is not the only one in the Republican Party worried about what Paul Ryan stands for.
Yeah.
And I happen to think...
You mean the Medicare
thing? The Medicare thing. He's been involved in Medicare in the past when he was Speaker. And I happen to think one of the important things Ryan did was he said, if we're going to be serious, we have to be serious about entitlements. We can't just be for expanding Medicare coverage forever. But there are people in the party on talk radio and also people like Gingrich who said, no, we should never, never touch this.
Yeah.
And so he was speaking to something serious. He did it in the most damaging way to his party possible.
Now, Tim Pawlenty's coming. It's almost definite that he's coming in the next few days. What's your reading on him right now?
Yeah, I think there are really three plausible candidates, Romney, Pawlenty, and Daniels, if he gets in. And I can easily see a path to the nomination for Pawlenty because he's the one person without any strong negatives. And he's fine. He was a good governor. He speaks well. He's fine. And so various people compare him to the Dukakis of the race. He comes from a working-class background, which that will play well. He's a good guy. So he doesn't, so far he hasn't aroused any excitement, and so far he hasn't really defined himself as more than just a generic Republican. But that might be fine. That might be good enough. So he's a very serious player worth paying a lot of attention to.
You agree?
I think anybody who's a governor and been reelected as a governor, especially in a state that's politics have been dominated by the other party, is a plausible candidate. Jim, running for president, it's a far higher altitude than any of these people have ever flown at before. It's a lot tougher than running for governor. The scrutiny that attaches, I mean, you're 50,000 feet up in the air and everybody sees everything you do, and especially now in our YouTube world. So we'll find out with Tim Pawlenty. One wild card for him is with Mike Huckabee not running, I think it encourages Michelle Bachmann to run, the congresswoman from Minnesota as well.
Same state, yeah.
And who has there's a built-in constituency in Iowa for either her or Sarah Palin among social and cultural conservatives and religious conservatives who are very influential in the Republican nominating process. And Tim Pawlenty has to do well.
Because of the Iowa caucus.
Iowa caucus. Yeah. He has to do well there. And if one of them takes the oxygen out of the room, it could... His campaign could suffer a real blow right at the beginning.
What about Huntsman? Any reading on him? Is it too early?
Yeah, well, we've talked about his core problem that he worked for Barack Obama.
Yeah.
He is the more moderate.
But he said he kind of takes that, he didn't see it that way.
Yeah, well, he doesn't, but I guarantee you a lot of Republican primary voters are going to see it, especially when Barack Obama embraces him rhetorically at every opportunity. Yeah. He's by far the most moderate in the party. He was, before he took this job with Obama as the China ambassador, he was seen as the moderate hope in the party. And so he, if there is a moderate wing left, and people decide Michelle Bachmann wins Iowa, everybody goes, oh my gosh, let's get somebody who seems reasonable. He would have a shot. I think it's an outside shot because of the Obama problem.
Okay, speaking of President
Obama. Can you say one thing, Mike Huckabee? Because you asked last week about Mike Huckabee.
Yes, I did.
And I said I didn't know he was going to run. Yep. I should have known because Mike Huckabee Huckabee had gained 25 pounds since 2008. And if you're going to run for national office, you get a personal trainer. And you lose that 25.
I thought you were a trained observer.
And I know it. It hit me when I saw him last Saturday night announce it. I said, Mike, you've been in the refrigerator. And Haley Barber had not.
He was
Haley
too large
Barber
on the screen. When
yeah,
he made,
that's it. No, exactly.
And Newt Gingrich now suing his personal trainer.
That's right.
But you just ruined my segue.
I was about to say,
David, speaking of President Obama, what did you make of his speech and what happened today with Netanyahu in the Middle East?
Yeah, I thought the speech, the parts that concerned the Arab Spring were very good, very strong, put us on the right side. I was less impressed with the parts concerning Israel, and for this reason. It is obviously true in the abstract that the final settlement will have to involve the 67 borders with land swaps. So to that degree, what the president said was blindingly obvious. But we're not talking about this situation in the abstract. We're talking about it in a concrete historical circumstance. And in that circumstance, Israel has just withdrawn from Gaza, took away settlements, and it didn't lead to peace. It led to more violence and threats. The same thing happened in Lebanon. So the people of Israel are nervous about just giving away land right now until they're sure they have a partner. Meanwhile, on the Palestinian side, you've got this Hamas-PA alliance, which is a problem to say the least. So to me, this is a very unlikely moment for there to be Middle East peace. And for the president to pick this fight in this particular circumstance seems to me not a worthy thing to do.
Well, you don't agree with Jane Harman and Steve Hadley that something could come from this? Because
I'm an outlier in this. I go there every year, and every year they've got another plan on the table, the Alone plan, the Mitchell plan, the Quartet plan, the Oslo process. And to my mind, and again, I'm an outlier on this, I think the idea we're going to draw magic lines on a map and solve this thing is not real. I don't think it's about territory. Mm-hmm. I think they have competing narratives, they have competing moral systems, competing historical hurts. Unless you deal with those underlying cultural and social problems, I don't think some magic line on a map is going to do it.
Well, you are personal. I'll be personal. I have personally negotiated peace in the Middle East about 40 times on this program, so I don't know what you're talking about. What was your reading of it?
As someone who's been critical of the president, I thought it was the right speech to make.
Said the right things.
I agree with Jane Harman. I thought that in the cusp, or perhaps even in the middle of what the 2012 campaign is going to be, it was a bold statement to make. And a realistic statement. The reality is that Israel is in danger of being isolated, and the United States alone with it. And I think this is a dangerous, dangerous time for Israel internationally. I think the president's going to Europe. He had to have. He was really forced to make a statement by Prime Minister Netanyahu coming here, and with his invitation from Speaker Boehner to speak to the Congress, that was going to dominate the discussion. That we're going to have elections in Egypt, and we want to preserve and strengthen the peace relations between Israel and Egypt, and with Jordan. And I just think it was that we have to move forward on this. We have to change. And I think that's really important, and I think it was an important message for him to deliver.
Yeah, well, you know, I was in Israel yesterday, in Europe yesterday when the speech was made, and the reaction in Europe was finally an American president spanking Israel, finally an American president saying Israel is the problem, is the obstacle to peace. And when the Israelis feel that from the European community, when they feel that from the Arab world, that interpretation, believe me, it's not an inducement to peace. But reminding people how weak they are and how history is running against them is not an inducement to a country to take risks. And so I just don't think the circumstances are particularly right until we have a Palestinian Authority, which is going to acknowledge the Jewish state of Israel, until there's some sense of security on the Israeli side. I understand why, if you want to sort of, Obama did sort of spank a lot of the Arab leaders. And I understand why, for the sake of balance, you want to, you know, make them feel better.
Particularly Assad.
Right. Yeah. And so I understand the sort of geostrategic. I personally don't think it's a right moment for peace.
Finally, quickly, President Obama went to thank the CIA today. What you're reading, did the CIA come out of its difficult times now? Is it doing better with in terms of image and deservedly so?
Yes. Morale at the CIA has been low, really, for the since the 70s. And they've been criticized a lot, whether it's questionable interrogation or whatever else. They've seemed to take a lot of hits. I give Leon Panetta a lot of credit for raising the morale there, for going in with just one staff person and saying, you're the professionals, I want to work with you, I depend on you. And this is a great success. And they, the celebrating success of any agency, it's good for any agency. It's good for the country. And it's sort of it's the CIA emerging from the shadows. It's becoming a more active player, especially as we draw down from Iraq and start to draw down from Afghanistan, the role of the CIA is going to be even more independent.
See, I'll make a general point. Republicans and Democrats, when you ask the political appointees, what's the quality of the professional staff in your agency? Whether they're Republicans or Democrats, they almost invariably say, surprisingly high, considering the salaries and everything they get, which are not so high. But the people who are in government, they're surprisingly good at it. And the CIA has its problems. I still have my problems with the way they do analysis. But to go for a president to go to an agency and celebrate career people who are not making a lot of money, probably always worth doing, whatever the agency.
Thank you.